So, due to a shortage of time, I will just go through briefly the points which are essential for visual rehabilitation after the surgery is over. So, managing children with congenital cataract is a complex, long-term process which requires considerable input from the parents who are responsible for the occlusion, optical correction, long-term follow-up, as well as the high healthcare expenditure. The crucial points regarding follow-up after cataract surgery, the essential things are refractive correction followed by amblyopia therapy as well as a frequent follow-up to monitor for complications. Refractive correction of course depends whether the child was left aphakic or pseudophakic. When the child is aphakic, rehabilitation can be done by various modes. It's necessary to remember that frequent examination under anesthesia may be required, especially in younger children, for suture removal, refraction and monitoring of IOP. Spectacles are the most satisfactory correction for bilateral aphakia. However, reality check is that the high aphakic glasses, lenses scratch and the frames break easily. They're difficult to replace due to expense and unavailability, and they're not suitable for monocular aphakia. Contact lens may be the best optical device theoretically in post-operative unilateral as well as bilateral aphakia. Various types of contact lenses are available. Commonly, what we are using right now are the hydrogel lenses as well as the RGP lenses. However, again, the reality check is that in our scenario, contact lenses have a high level of non-compliance because of difficulty in insertion and removal. They're expensive and easily lost. Suboptimal living standards and scarcity of clean water make ocular hygiene difficult and lead to increased percentage of corneal complications. Follow-up is also difficult due to cost and the distance of travel. Due to these scenarios, secondary intraocular lenses might be a better option because they provide a constant high quality visual input immediately after surgery and ensure compliance with amblyopia therapy. However, the long-term safety of intraocular lens is questionable, especially in younger children and in shorter axial lengths. Secondary intraocular lens can be planned depending on the adequacy of the capsular rim. We can plan an in-the-bag lens, ciliary sulcus fixation or a scleral fixated IOL. Timing of surgery can be planned anytime after 2 years of age. Again, a reality check is that in all publications, a foldable hydrophobic acrylic lens is the most recommended intraocular lens in children. However, this costs almost $100, which is a prohibitive cost in our situation. The good news is that PMMA lenses can be implanted in children, especially older than 2 years of age, and when implanting in the ciliary sulcus, and these are available for as less as 150 rupees. Also, both Aurolab and Appaswamy Associates have recently introduced Indian hydrophobic foldable lenses, which are available for less than half the cost of the foreign lenses. We don't have too much experience with these lenses at the moment, but hopefully this will be a solution to the problem of not being able to implant lenses in the youngest children. Refractive correction in pseudophakia, again with primary implantation of IOL in even the youngest children with planned undercorrection, implies that nearly all infants will have an amblyogenic residual hyperopia which needs to be corrected. Amblyopia therapy is essential for correcting the ocular dominance, and a long-term occlusion therapy may be required till 8 to 9 years of age. The most common complication which needs to be monitored for and which may be as amblyogenic as the original cataract is posterior capsular opacification, which may be seen in 39 to 100% of cases with intact posterior capsule. The other factors which may predispose for development of a PCO are a small PPC with a shallow anterior vitrectomy, a very young age at surgery, traumatic cataract, ciliary sulcus fixation of intraocular lenses and subsequent ocular inflammation. Yang capsulotomy is difficult in children because of poor cooperation and nystagmus, is not effective in thick PCO, and there is a high rate of recurrence. In these cases, it may be better to go ahead with a surgical membranectomy, either via a limbal approach or a pars plana approach. Strabismus, approximately 50% of all children with cataracts may develop strabismus, especially the youngest of children. Going into rehabilitation of the children who have a permanent visual impairment, rehabilitation involves combined and coordinated use of medical, social, educational and vocational measures for training the individual to the highest possible level of functional ability. Low vision care of children with visual impairment early in life could potentially minimize long-term permanent visual disability and reduce the number of blind years. Special assistive devices are available both for education and for mobility and vocational devices. It is difficult to plan low vision services in the tertiary areas because this usually requires the efforts of a coordinated team, including a low vision specialist, special education workers, the teachers and the parents. Now, multiple new initiatives are now prevalent for low vision services. Strengthening low vision service is one of the focus areas under the 11th five-year plan under NPCB. Financial assistance is being provided for optical and non-optical devices by the NPCB. And it's heartening to know that the scheme for integrated education of partially sighted children is being enforced even in private schools, at least in urban areas. Ultimately, I would again like to offer a reality check. As presented by Dr. Suma, in our study, we have a reasonable follow-up with only a 24% of children dropping out at 2 months. But in the study conducted in sub-Saharan Africa, of 154 children who underwent pediatric cataract, only 66.9% attended a 2-week follow-up and only 43% attended the 10-week follow-up. So in conclusion, a significant investment in surgical interventions may not lead to improved visual rehabilitation or quality of life if investments in follow-up are not increased. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vash.